is about holding justice, upholding justice. In fact, one of the main strategies of Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, main objective when he accepted the Khilafah, is that he would accept the Khilafah only to uphold justice and to dispel injustice. Otherwise, our Imam alayhi salam and all our other Imams, they have no desire in ruling and governance. They don't care about power at all. If they accept power, they accept it for one reason and one reason only, and that is to support the oppressed, to stand up with the needy and the underprivileged, and to dispel and fight injustice in the community. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran that the purpose of sending all the prophets and revealing all those divine books, the Quran, the Torah, the Injil, is to uphold justice in the society. Inna arsalna rusulana bil bayinat wa anzalna ma'ahum al hadida wal mizan, kitaba wal hadida wal mizan liyaquma an-nasu bil qist. I have sent all those prophets and all those messages, and I brought down the scale and all those books so people would uphold justice and abhor injustice. Look today, my dear brothers and the sisters today. We live in a time that we call it the 21st century, a century of education, enlightenment, sophistication, innovations. Yes, that's all true. But there is one thing missing in this world, my dear brothers and sisters, and that is justice among nations. Look around and see what's going on in this world. There are nations and people who are being massacred day in and day out, before the eyes of the international community, before the superpowers, and nobody would do anything. You can go all the way from China and the way it deals with its Muslim minority, the Uyghurs, all the way to Burma or Myanmar, in which the Muslim community are being persecuted. Over 1 million Muslims from Myanmar were forced, the Rohingya, were forced to leave their hometowns. Their wives were raped, their homes were razed, their entire villages were knocked down, and many of their young people were massacred and killed. Go to Palestine, where the Zionists are ruling now. Go to Yemen, where over 23 million innocent people are facing starvation and famine, and the world would not do anything to save them. All the way to other spots in the world, my dear brothers and sisters, where injustice has prevailed and justice has become a desire that awaits to be realized among many people. We go back to our beloved Imam, Al-Imam Musa Al-Kadhim alayhi salam. He took a very harsh stand against injustice, against unjust rulers. He would tell his friends and his associates to stay away from helping unjust rulers, because if you help the unjust rulers, in fact, you will be an accomplice. And if the oppressors do not find other people to help them facilitate and further conduct and perpetrate their injustice, they will not be able to be tyrants anymore. It is with the help of the accomplices, people who would look for their own personal interest by helping the tyrant. That's why we have a hadith narrated from our holy prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, in which he says, "Sharrun nas man ba'a akhiratahu bidunya." The worst person is the one who sells out his akhirah, his hereafter, for the sake of his dunya. Then the prophet says, "Wa sharrun min," and worse than that person, "man ba'a akhiratahu bidunya ghayri," someone who sells his akhirah not for his dunya, rather for the dunya of someone else, in order for Harun al-Rashid to enjoy the lure of this dunya, someone would sell himself to the shaitan. In order to this tyrant to enjoy, I become a tool for his injustice and oppression. So the Imam alayhi salam took a very hard stand against the oppressive leaders and tyrants. So much so that he had one of his companions named Safwan al-Jamal. Safwan al-Jamal owned a fleet of camels, over 450 camels, that he would use for commercial reasons. And he would rent them out to transfer people from a city to another. So it was during Hajj time that the tyrant Harun al-Rashid asked Safwan al-Jamal to rent him out all his camels so he can put people on them and send them to Hajj, to help people go to Hajj. And Harun was basically confirming the transaction. He was handling the transaction. He would rent out those camels. So the Imam heard about the deal. He sent a letter to Safwan, basically rebuking him for dealing with the tyrant, for striking any kind of deal with the tyrant, for being an enabler and facilitator. Safwan replied to the Imam that, "Yabna Rasulullah, O the Son of God, yes, I am dealing with the tyrant, but I'm not renting him out something haram. I'm not doing something haram. I'm helping him out in helping Hujjaj to get to Hajj, to transfer Hujjaj to go to Mecca. And this is a noble cause." The Imam alayhi salam says, "Yes, indeed, it is a noble cause to help the Hujjaj. However, Safwan, when this person will pay you your payment, whatever he owes you, when? Before Hajj or after Hajj?" Safwan says, "No, he will pay me after Hajj. After Hajj is over, he will pay me. He's supposed to pay me." The Imam told him, "Look, Ya Safwan, you wish in your heart that Harun stays in power till after Hajj so he can pay you your money, right?" He says, "Yes." He says, "That's what Allah will hold you accountable for. For wishing for a tyrant to stay a little longer, it is a sin. You are an accomplice. Only by wishing for the tyrant to stay. Not alone if you become an oppressor. No, even by wishing for a tyrant to stay and to survive. When we do Ziyarat Ashura and we speak to Imam Hussein, we address him, we curse two groups of people. La'an Allahu ummatan qatalat. May Allah curse those who participated directly in murdering you. Wa la'an Allahu ummatan sami'at bidhalika faradiyat. And may Allah curse those who heard about your martyrdom and they were happy with it." That's how dangerous oppression is. That if you're not an oppressor yourself, rather someone who would sympathize with the oppressors, who would wish they stay in power, who would say, well, today we wish Saddam was still there in Iraq after seeing the problems. Or we wish that Shah had stayed in power. This is a sinful wishing when you wish for a tyrant to be still in power. Al-Imam alayhi salam, Imam Al-Kadhim, unlike the scholars of his time, he would never cozy to the tyrants. Many of the scholars of his time would go to Harun al-Rashid, they visit him, they show him respect, they try to appease him, they cozy to him, but not al-Imam al-Kadhim alayhi salam. He refused completely to recognize the oppressor regime. He refused to legalize the rule. One person comes to the Imam alayhi salam one day and he says, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, we know that Islam has forbidden Muslims from helping the oppressors. Allah says, وَلَا تَرْكَنُوا إِلَى الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا فَتَمَسَّكُمُ النَّارِ. Do not succumb to those oppressors, for fire may touch you. This person asked Al-Imam Al-Kadhim, he says, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, my job is I am a tailor and I sew a garment for the Khalifa, for Harun and his entourage. Am I considered min a'wan al-zalam, part of the oppressors, helper and enablers, by me sewing their basically garment and their official outfit? Am I considered an enabler to the oppressor? The Imam alayhi salam says, you as a tailor, you are an oppressor. As a tailor for the tyrant, you are an oppressor. The one who sells you the thread and the fabric, that is considered enabler. But for you, you are an oppressor yourself. You go and make income, your income, out of what the tyrant gives you. And you enjoy that coziness with the tyrant. And then you ask me if you are an enabler to the tyrant? Of course you are, of the oppressors themselves. So that's how the Imam alayhi salam takes a stand. Another companion and a student of the Imam alayhi salam, his name is Ali ibn Yaqtin. Ali ibn Yaqtin was a very talented person with administrative skills that Harun was interested in hiring him as the prime minister. So Ali ibn Yaqtin sent a letter to Imam al-Kadhim alayhi salam, asking him if he can work for Harun the tyrant as a prime minister. Would the Imam allow this? The Imam says basically no. You're not supposed to work for him. However, kafaratu amal al-sultan qada hawa'ij al-ikhwan. He says there is a kafara, there is a retribution for you if you decide to work as a prime minister for Harun. And the retribution and the kafara for that is that you dedicate your position to helping the oppressed and the needy. Not that you enjoy power. Not that you quench your thirst for power. This is haram. But if your intention is by becoming prime minister is to help the poor, the underprivileged, the weak, the vulnerable, and to utilize your position to advance justice in the society, then that's fine. That would be your kafara, your retribution. The Imam alayhi salam was very patient and resilient in his stand. So much so that he had to pay a very, very heavy price for his oppositions to the tyrant. The Imam could have not opposed the tyrant and enjoyed a relaxed and loose life in which he would accept gifts and grants from the tyrant, as many of his contemporary would do. But no, the Imam, feeling that he is the representative of the Prophet, he is the genuine representative of Islam, he cannot condone the oppression and injustice done by this arrogant man, Harun al-Rashid. Harun was so arrogant that he would talk, he would address the clouds. He would say, "Sharqi aw gharbi, fala tamturina illa fi mulki, wa ya'tini kharajuki." He would address the clouds by telling, "Go to the left, go to the right, go to east, go to west, and rain wherever you want to rain, for you will rain in my property, in my property." He considers the Muslim country his own property. That's how he viewed the Muslim country. And he viewed Muslims as his own slaves. And he considered the treasury of Muslims as his own. One historian say that every day his dinner table would cost, Harun's dinner table would cost the treasury 10,000 gold dinar. 10,000 gold dinar. Now, remember, every dinar, gold dinar, consists of 40 grams of gold. 40 grams of gold. So, 40 grams of gold times 10,000. How much that would be by today's value and by today's money? God knows, hundreds of thousands, probably millions of dollars. His dining table would cost. How much he would eat? He would eat a little bit, and then they throw the rest into garbage. That's how wasteful he was. That's how arrogant he was. And that's why our imams, alayhim salam, not only took a stand against him, but against all other oppressors who preceded him from the Abbasi empire. But our Imam alayhi salam paid a heavy price. The price was that he had to spend several years in Harun's prison. Some say 7 years, and some go all the way to 14 years that the Imam spent of his precious life in the prison, only because he would not say yes to the tyrant. Harun would love to hear the Imam saying, "Yes, I accept you as the leader of Muslims. I pledge allegiance to you." And then he will be free and he will not have to face the agony of being in jail for 7 or 14 years. None of that anguish. But the Imam could not lie to himself or to his followers or to his Lord. He has to be a true leader, an honest leader in defending the mustadhafin, the underprivileged, the weak, the vulnerable, and not to condone the tyranny. When the Imam first put in jail, his dua was this. What a nice dua. إلهي طالما كنت أسألك أن تفرغني لعبادتك وهاك قد فعلت. My Lord, I always ask you for time in which I can dedicate it fully for ibadah, for worship, for worshiping you, for supplication, for prayers, for reciting Quran. Being an imam in the leadership position in Medina, his time could be limited due to the fact that he was dealing with people, receiving people, helping people, living with people. So he didn't have much time to spend, or at least he didn't have as much time he wished to have to spend in ibadah, worship, and supplication. Even though he spent a lot of his time, even in Medina, in worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But even though he, even in Medina, he spent much of his time in worship, but he was still wanting, he wanted to spend more time with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of us pray, but we pray so fast. We pray and we are hurrying up to finish with the prayer because we want to go after our mundane business, our businesses, our families, our jobs, our homes. The Imam would love enjoying his time in worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, my Lord, I had asked you to allow me to dedicate more time for my worship. And now you did answer me by giving me this opportunity. By being in a prison, I have nothing else to do other than worshiping. You see, my dear brothers and sisters, when other people take this as a sad and bad luck to end up in a prison, the Imam doesn't take it as a bad luck. In fact, the Imam takes being in a prison as an opportunity for him, that this opportunity was not available when he was in Medina due to the fact of him exercising his leadership and being a leader to the community and to the Muslims and reaching out to the community and taking care of his people. But now in prison, he has nothing to do other than worshiping Allah. He spends much of his time worshiping Allah. He spent much of his time supplicating and worshiping Allah, reciting Quran. During the day, he is fasting, and at night, he is praying the midnight prayer and the nafila and the extra prayer. So that's how he would spend his time. He is happy wholeheartedly that he is in a prison because that gave him an opportunity to worship Allah and to be closer to Allah and to spend more time with his Lord. And that's how he spent his time. Years passed, months passed, and the Imam would never complain. Till during toward the end of his imprisonment, Harun would send instructions to the jailer, whose name was As-Sindi, asking him to be very tough with the Imam, to reduce the amount of food he offers, to reduce the amount of the Imam being able to be in the open air, rather to keep him underground, in shackles, and chains. So those brutal and cruel measures started to take toll on the Imam, started to make him frustrated and impatient. His hands and his legs were chained in shackles that he barely can move his hand or his legs. One day, the door of the prison was open, and the Imam alayhi salam was craving for some fresh air. As he was in his chains, shackled in the chains, the Imam alayhi salam tried to crawl toward the door so he can breathe some fresh air. When the jailer noticed that the Imam is heading to the entrance, he thought the Imam is trying to escape. How can he escape when he is chained in shackles and he cannot even move freely? So the jailer Sindi ibn Shahik approached the Imam alayhi salam, and I am so embarrassed and heartbroken to say that the man dared to slap the Imam on his face, so powerful that the Imam fell on his face. And he pulled the imam inside the prison and he locked the door on him. During those difficult days where the imam cannot tell what time is it, it is day or night, the imam cannot tell. He was in a cell underground that no light can reach it, and therefore the imam cannot even tell whether it is daytime now or nighttime. But the imam was still patient. However, his tone changed, his dua changed. After being tortured in that cell, day in, day out, after being denied water and denied food, the imam's patience was running thin, and he would raise his hand, Ya مخلص الشجر من بين تراب وطين, يا مخلص اللبن من بين فرث ومشيمة, خلصني يا مخلص الطفل من بين مشيمة ورحم, خلصني من سجن هارون. Oh, you the one who saves an infant, a fetus, from the womb of his mother. Oh, you the one who saves a tree from dirt and a clay. I ask you to rid me from the Harun prison. That was his dua, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would release him. When I say release him, not necessarily alive. No, the imam was aspiring to be released from the prison of Harun, even if he was dead. That's how much under torture the imam was. That's how under stress he was, that he basically were yearning to leave this prison altogether. One of his, or some of his companions, send him a letter. Yabna Rasulullah, Sayyidana, our master, our leader, we miss you. It has been several years you're in a prison. We cannot reach you. We cannot see you. We cannot talk to you. We cannot talk to our leader. We cannot communicate. The imam has been put in a prison for so many years that he cannot see none of his friends and companions. They said, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, we miss you. لَقَدْ تَاقَتْ إِلَيْكَ نُفُوسُنَا. Tell us when you will be out of prison so we can come out and welcome you and embrace you. The imam sent a letter to them that my appointment with you is on a Friday on the bridge, on Baghdad's bridge. His followers believe that the imam will be released that day and he will be set out of prison and he will be set free. So a group of them, a group of the followers of Ahlul Bayt gathered on a Friday on 25 of Rajab, like today, and it was a Friday. They gathered at the bridge of Baghdad, hoping to see the imam coming out of prison free and celebrating his freedom. All of a sudden, they saw four soldiers, Abbasi soldiers, carrying a casket. They brought this casket and they put the casket on the bridge. And they started shouting, Hada Imam al-Rafida. This is the Imam of the Rafidis. A word they use to basically belittle the Shia. Hada Imam al-Rafida. This is the Imam of the Rafidis. Ala wa man arada fal yashhad janazata Musa ibn Ja'far fal yashhad. So they realized that this is the imam. This is the body of the imam, alayhi salam. The imam didn't make it alive. He was poisoned by Harun in prison. And he would meet his Lord as a martyr. And he would come out of the from his prison as a martyr. And when we recite the ziyara of al-Imam al-Kadhim, this is what we usually say. As-salamu ala al-mu'adhabi fi qa'ar al-sujood wa dhulam al-matamir dis-saq al-mardhud bi-halaq al-hadid wal-janazat al-munada alayha bi-dhull al-istighfaf. Peace be upon the man who was being tortured in a prison cells, in the darkness of those cells. Peace be upon the man who was shackled in chains, and his body was carried with so much disrespect and so much lack of respect for him and for his family. The Shia community came and they took the body. They do the ghusl, the washing, they do the kafan, and thousands of the followers of the Imam took the Imam to his final destination, to his final resting place, thousands of the Shia. And today, my dear brothers and sisters, right now that I'm speaking to you, there are hundreds of thousands of followers of Imam al-Kadhim are flocking his shrine, marking his martyrdom, marking the day he was alone, but yet he was embraced by his followers who took him to his final resting destination. There was one shaheed, one martyr that he had no person, no community, no followers to take him and to do ghusl for him and to do taghseel for him or takfeen for him or to bury him properly, and that was Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. Ma ghassalu wa ma laffawhu fi kafani. The poet says they never washed him, they never put him in kafan, and he was never being buried properly with thousands of followers attending his tashyi'. And this is our beloved Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Assalamu ala al-Hussein wa ala awlad al-Hussein wa ala Ali ibn al-Hussein wa ala ashab al-Hussein wa salamu ala sayyidina al-Imam Musa al-Kadhim salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. The day he was born and the day he was martyred and the day he is resurrected in the day of judgment. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My dear brothers and sisters, we have a few minutes, some 10 minutes remaining for the program. For those brothers and sisters who have any question, please go ahead and ask your questions, and inshallah, I will do my best to answer those questions.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Taqabbalallah wa taqabbala anfasakum. Thank you.
Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullah. Thank you so much, my dear brother Haj Nawruz Zada. Thank you so much.
It's an honor to have you on the program, and alhamdulillah, the topic of your discussion was very appropriate in the sense that obviously the lives of our ma'sumin examples, they are role models for all us to follow. The question I have, which is a very basic question, but obviously, you know, if there is time, because it probably has a very comprehensive answer, but I would like you to summarize. We are in awaiting. We are waiting for the reappearance of our 12th Imam, who will bring justice and equality and peace to the world. The total number of Shia in the world today are probably between 200 to 250 million. But he is the Munji Alam Hasti. He's not coming just for the Shias. He's coming for the whole of mankind and so forth. So my question is this: how can we, as followers of the Imam, Ajalallah Ta'ala Faraju Sharif, in our daily lives, implement this waiting period so that we can get closer to the Imam? That's my basic question. So especially the youth, because obviously, you know, there's a lot of things happening around the world today. There's a huge amount of oppression. Wherever you look, there is oppression, there is injustice, and so forth. So how can we follow the Imam in a manner that is to his, let's say, obviously we seek the satisfaction of the Almighty, but obviously we do have a savior who is out there, who is living and amongst us.
It's a very good question. In Islam, we are asked not only to love Ahlul Bayt, rather to follow Ahlul Bayt. Many Muslims, non-Shia, basically, and I can say basically most Muslims, if not the entire Muslim Ummah, they do love Ahlul Bayt. Today, you hardly can find someone who doesn't love Ahlul Bayt, unless some of those fringe extremist groups that are shunned by Muslims themselves, even by Sunnis. But almost all Muslims love Ahlul Bayt. But that's not enough just to love Ahlul Bayt. Islam wants us to follow Ahlul Bayt. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam was preaching Islam in Mecca, Meccans will tell the Prophet, why do you care about this religion that you want us to follow you? We love God. We love God. Isn't that what you want? Allah answers, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ. If you love God and you want God to love you, by loving God only, God doesn't guarantee his love for you. Rather, by following God through following his messenger. Only by loving Ahlul Bayt, that's not enough. We need to follow Ahlul Bayt. This is why there was Ahlul Bayt and there is Ahlul Bayt. Not just to love them, rather to follow them. They have been a role model for Muslims, not only for them to be loved in my heart, but rather to imitate them. And the word, if we focus on the word Shia, what does Shia mean in the linguistic root? It means a follower, not a lover. We are called Shia to Ali, not because we only love Ali, rather we are supposedly follow Ali alayhi salam. We follow Ahlul Bayt. So if we want to stay close to Ahlul Bayt and basically even expedite the appearance of our beloved Imam, the only way for that is that we follow the footsteps of Ahlul Bayt, to act like them, to basically speak like them, to have them as our role models. Whatever our imams did, we just follow. Whatever message our imams preached, messages of unity, messages of not being divided, messages of not being captivated by the lure of this dunya, a message of piety and message of humility. Whenever we implement those messages into our daily life, then we can probably claim that we get closer to Ahlul Bayt alayhim assalam. There was a guy, his name is Shaqran. Shaqran was somehow related to Ahlul Bayt. I'm not going to go in details because it's a little bit complicated. So he was somehow related to Ahlul Bayt. So Al-Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam used to hear things unfortunate things about Shakran, that, for example, he may drink or he may do things that are inappropriate. The Imam alayhi salam sent him a small note one day. Ya Shakran, inna al-qabih min kulli ahadin qabih wa minka aqbah. Sins are bad from everybody, but from you, they look even worse. والحسن من كل حسنين من كل حد من أحد حسن ومنك أحسن. And when you do حسنة, and when you do a good deed, doing a good deed is a good thing for anybody, but for you, it is even better. Then the Imam explains why. He says لمكانك منا, because of your relationship with us. When you do sin, people will attack us, attack Ahlul Bayt. People will say, look at the followers of Ahlul Bayt. Look how loose they are. The blame and the ugliness of the sin will be directed and blamed on our imams. But when we do something good deeds, and we imitate our imams feel proud of us. حتى يقول الناس هكذا أدب Ja'far ibn Muhammad in Shi'ata. So people can say, look how beautifully Imam Ja'far disciplined his followers. So to answer by two words, I would say it is very important that we not only cry for our imams during their martyrdom, and it is not only we celebrate, which is a good thing, but also to keep in mind that they must remain the role model for us. Their men have to remain role model for our men. Their women must remain role models for our women. Their children would be role models for our children. So by following the footsteps of Ahlul Bayt, we can make our Imam proud and happy, and probably we can even expedite the appearance of our beloved Imam Al-Mahdi Ajjalallah Faraj.
Thank you very much, Hajjah. Thank you. That was, a very comprehensive but brief answer. And alhamdulillah, it has been very enlightening. One more question that I personally have, because this is also a contemporary issue. We have seen in the past 6 to 9 months an awakening amongst the black community across the world, who undoubtedly have suffered huge miseries. And, you know, their rights have been abused. In the context of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, what is the view and indeed the relationship of the imams with the black community, and what is the, if there is a relationship, then can you clarify that?
It's a very good question. One time, a non-Muslim white Christian scholar told me, that was a few years ago, that Islam has become a magnet for African American here in America. And I agree with him. Islam lately has become a magnet for many African American. In fact, the trend of conversion to Islam has been accelerating recently, even among prisoners in a prison. You know, those prisoners, once they are in prison, they have nothing to do. So there is no crime to commit. What they do, sometimes they utilize their time in reading. And once they read, they find Islam and eventually Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. I had a guy who came to me a few years ago, probably 3 years ago, a white American actually. He told me that when I was in a prison, he committed a crime. He was a soldier in Iraq, and he committed a crime that he had to pay the price for it. So he was imprisoned in the U.S. He says, while in a prison, I became Muslim and I converted to Islam and I became Maliki. And he says, as I was reading the biography of Imam Malik ibn Anas, I found out that his teacher is Ja'far al-Sadiq. So I said to myself, this friend, this convert says, he says, I said to myself, why not go and study the biography of the teacher instead of the student? And when I studied the biography of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, I converted to Islam. We know that Islam is probably the only religion today that practically and theoretically does not discriminate against people. For example, in a Christianity, theoretically, there is no discrimination against colored people, meaning the Christianity as it is preached, it preaches for all people, black and white. But if you come to America on Sunday, especially Sunday before noon, you find America is going through its most segregated movement, where all whites go to white churches, predominantly white churches, and blacks go to predominantly black churches. You hardly see Christians, black and white, mingling in one church. You hardly see that in this country. But with Islam, if you enter any masjid here in America, you see African American standing next to a white American, Arab American, Afghani American, Iranian American. This is the beauty of Islam. In Ashura, when we tell the story of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, that the way he treated his black companion, which is Joan, strikingly similar to the way he treated his own biological son, Ali al-Akbar. He offered a farewell bid to John by putting his cheek on the cheek of John. And he did the same gesture to Ali al-Akbar. And the last word uttered by John was, someone says, I heard him whispering, saying something and smiling. And when I came, an eyewitness says, when I came to listen to him closely, what he was saying, "Man mithli wa ibn Rasulillah wada'un khaddahu ala khaddi." What an honor that the son of Rasulullah, the son of the messenger of Allah, is putting his cheek on my cheek. A gesture of love, a gesture of humility, a gesture of embrace. This happens only in Islam and in the school of Ahlul Bayt. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam had a black servant, Qambar, and he would go with his black servant to the market to buy two pieces of clothes. And the Imam buys a fancy one and one, a humble one. And Qambar thought that the Imam bought the fancy for him, for Imam Ali. And he bought the humble one for Qambar. For his surprise, the Imam gave the fancy to his black slave, black servant, and he took the humble one. And when Qambar was surprised, he says, "Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, you're the Khalifa. You're the one who stands on the top of the minbar and speak to people. You need to wear something fancy." He says, "No. Ya Qambar, anta shab wa fika sharahu shabab. I'm an old person. You're a young person. You like to wear fancy things. And that's why I bought this for you." And Imam Ali alayhi salam has another student named Maytham al-Tammar. He was black. He was a black slave that the Imam purchased and set free. Maytham owned a small store in which he sells watermelon in winter and date in, I'm sorry, watermelon in summer and date in winter. Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, who was at the time the head of the state, a leader of the state, a statesman equivalent to a king or president that covered 58 countries on now political map, he would come and sit by Maytha. Some people pass by not knowing that Imam Ali is the caliph. Maytham would go out of his store for a few minutes to do something, and the Imam stays in Maytham's store. Some people come to buy watermelon, they don't find Maytham. The Imam himself, he handles the sale. He sells them the watermelon. He takes the money and he gives it to his former slave, Maytham. This is how Ahlul Bayt lived. And you can preach a lot, but no preaching can match when you practice what you preach. Ahlul Bayt not only preached about equality, rather they practiced that equality. And that's why in Islam, we really don't have this problem of white and black, because Islam does not recognize those boundaries. And Allah, the Prophet says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَقُولُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ صُوَرِكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ صُوَرِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ. God does not look at the color of our skin. Rather, he looks at our heart, how pure it is. You can be a black, so what? Many of the great companions of our Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, such as Bilal and Miqdad, were black. Many of Imam Ali's companions were black. Many of the companions of other imams, such as Joan and others, were black. Al-Imam Al-Jawad, he looked almost black. And some people were questioning why. Because his mother was from Sudan. His mother was from Sudan. And Al-Imam Al-Ridha didn't waver in marrying a black woman, just to make us see that there is no difference. كلكم لآدم وآدم من تراب. You all belong to Adam, and Adam belongs to this earth.
Thank you very much. And inshallah, if there are any other questions from the audience, I'd like to come forth and although I know your time is short, but we wish we had much, much more time to spend with you, because every second and every minute of the time we spend with you is a barakah. You know, we're honestly learning, and alhamdulillah, you know, you are full of knowledge, and it's a huge honor to be listening to your words of wisdom.
That's kind of you, Hajj. That's kind of you.
It's a reality, and we have to recognize that, you know, persons and personalities such as yourself are hard to come by, you know, because it takes a lot of experience. And alhamdulillah, you know, you've been very active both in the social as well as the religious arena. So, you know, we have to benefit. And one of the things that unfortunately we don't realize is that, you know, it takes a lot of time to develop experience. And from experience and knowledge, we can only go forward. And inshallah.
I am only a khadim, Hajj Nawruzzadeh. I'm a khadim. I'm a servant, inshallah. If Ahlul Bayt accepts me as a khadim, I hope I will be a khadim to them and to their followers, to their Shia, inshallah.
Thank you very much. And you are our esteemed guest of honor. And it's a huge pleasure to have you. So, agar dostani hastan ki mikhan ba jagha صحبت بکنن یا سوالی دارن من فعلا از همگی خداحافظی میکنم ولی چیز به اصطلاح نوبت به دیگران انشالله میتیم که اگر سوالی چیز داشتن از آجاها انشالله سوال بفرمایند. خب حاج آقا اگر اجازه بدین که شما همین آخرین دعا رو بفرمایین و مریض هم زیاد داریم متاسفانه و برای گذشتگان بلخص از بیت حضرت آیت الله عظما فیاض آقای مهدوی که تازه به روزای خدا رفتن و همه گذشتگان خداوند انشاءالله بیامرزه و دوستانی که التماس دعا گفتن خیلی زیاد هستن و انشاءالله همه را خداوند قریق رحمت بکنه. بر محمد و آل بیت محمد صلوات بفرمایید.
اللهم صل على محمد و آل محمد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحیم. اللهم صل على محمد و آل محمد و بارك على محمد و آل محمد و ترحم على محمد و آل محمد و تحنن على محمد و آل محمد. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات. تابع اللهم بيننا وبينهم بالخيرات، إنك مجيب الدعوات، إنك قاضي الحاجات، إنك على كل شيء قدير. And to send some gift to the soul of our beloved deceased, and particularly Ayatollah Mahdawi and other deceased, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower their souls with his rahmah. I ask all my dear brothers and sisters to recite Surah Al-Mubarakah Al-Fatiha, preceded by salawat ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alamin. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki yawmid din. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladzina an'amta 'alayhim ghayril maghdubi 'alayhim waladh-dhalin. I would like to thank my dear brothers and sisters, the viewers, for their precious time taken today. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect them all, to protect their family members. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the shafa'a of Ahlul Bayt and our beloved Imam al-Imam al-Kadhim salamullahi alayhi on the Day of Judgment. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to also grant us their ziyarah inshallah in this dunya. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fulfill the hajat and the prayers of all sisters, the mu'mineen and mu'minat. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
As-salamu alayk ya Aba Abdillah wa ala al-arwah allati حلات بفنائك عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخرا عهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين ورحمة الله وبركاته.